Thank you for coming. I bet this room's going to get really warm by the end. I'm very envious of those German professors who don't get skepticism. That's life. Okay, well, since it was kind of an artistic place, I thought I'd begin with a poem, which was that. But I want to begin with another bit of literature, which is, actually, I began one of my books with this, Louise Bogan, a book called Journey Around My Room. And it says, the initial mystery that attends any journey is how did the traveler reach his starting point in the first place? And that's really what it's almost always about. All mysteries are about getting to the starting point. After that, it's easy. So what I want to do is bring you to the starting point of what is probably the biggest mystery in science. And then you'll be ready to be confused. So that's where we're going to head. Now, as pointed out, one of the subjects I want to talk about is this age-old question, which I understand is, which is not quite in the German version, but in the American version, of why is there something rather than nothing? It's a question that's been around as long as at least theologians have been around. And it is a question that's motivated for many people the existence of God. How did you create everything we see if there was nothing there to begin with? And so one can try and ask this question, and one can try and answer it. There are lots of ways to try and answer it. One is you could write a book that begins this way, and it doesn't answer anything about anything. It doesn't tell you anything useful. Or you could turn to the real universe, not the imaginary one. And so we can look at the real universe. And this is actually a recent picture, more recent than many of you may have seen. Some of you have seen different versions of this. This is the Hubble Deep Field, it's called, from the Hubble Space Telescope. And it's more recent because it's combined many different images from different colors, so it's the ultra-high spectral resolution version of the deep field, and if these dumb lights weren't on, you could see it better. But it's about 10,000 hours of Hubble time over the last bunch of years. Now, the great thing about this image is that every dot in this image is a galaxy. And there are no stars here, individual stars. Each galaxy contains about 100 billion stars. There are, as I will describe, about 100 billion galaxies in the observable universe. And so this is the universe we see and the one we wanted to try and explain. Well, it turns out that it's just what we can see is just the tip of a cosmic iceberg, as I'll try and describe. And our view of the universe has changed remarkably in a single human lifetime. That is perhaps, for me, the most poetically interesting thing about all of this, is that that there could be people in this audience who would have been around when our vision of the universe was a single galaxy, as I'll describe, located in a universe that was eternal and unchanging, and of course everything's changed about that. Now, the person who brought us into the modern era is this guy here. He's one of my heroes. This is Edwin Hubble, He's one of my heroes because he gives me great hope for humanity. I was just reading the paper again today, and it's so depressing lately. But he gives me hope for humanity because he began life as a lawyer and then became an astronomer. There's hope for even people in this room. This is him in 1925 in the Mount Wilson telescope, he did something very important. The first thing he did was remarkable. Up until 1925, the conventional wisdom among scientists was that the universe had one galaxy, our island universe, the Milky Way galaxy was it. And there was a debate because there were these little fuzzy things in our galaxy you could see with telescopes, and they were called nebulae, which is Latin for fuzzy thing, and there was a debate about what they were. And with the Mount Wilson telescope, he was able to resolve these nebulae and see that they were other island universes, other galaxies. And as I say, we went from one galaxy to now over 100 billion galaxies in 88 years or 89 years or so. That's changed tremendously. So that already would have made him famous in a way among scientists, but he did something else, and the something else changed everything because he discovered that the universe was expanding. It wasn't eternal, it wasn't fixed. And so what he did, there may be biologists in the audience, but these are not sperm, these are galaxies. This is schematically what he saw. So this is our galaxy, and as you look out, he discovered that galaxies were moving away from us on average, and remarkably, those that were twice as far away were moving twice as fast, and those that were three times as far away were moving three times as fast, and he codified this in something called Hubble's Law, which says velocity is proportional to distance. Now, When you see this picture, it's obvious what it implies. It implies that we are the center of the universe. And many of my friends suggested that I feel that way on a daily basis, but it doesn't imply that. It implies instead that the universe is expanding uniformly. Now, this is one of the hardest things for people to understand, because when you look at this, it's clear that there's a center and everything's moving away from that center. The problem is, and this is what's so great about science, is it takes us out of our myopic environment. It's really what's great about all literature and scholarship, is the idea it teaches you that what you think is natural, it may not be natural. And so we're myopic because we're stuck here. And so to really see what's happening, you have to get outside of our galaxy. Okay, most of us live in our galaxy, except the Republican Party in my country. But but I can create a universe easily enough that I can stand outside of, and it's a simpler universe. It's a two-dimensional universe. And in this universe, I can put galaxies at regular intervals. And you can see that if we're standing outside this universe, this is a small bit of the universe. Then at a later time, it's bigger. All the galaxies moved a little bit further away from each other. Now, what would you see if you lived in that universe, however? Well, pick a galaxy, any galaxy, say this one. What we can see what they see by superimposing this image on top of this image and putting that galaxy on top of itself. So what would you see from that galaxy? You'd see exactly what Hubble saw. Every galaxy is moving away from you, and those that are twice as far away move twice the distance in the same time. Those that are three times as away, far away, move three times the distance. And it doesn't matter what galaxy you pick. You see the same thing from absolutely every galaxy. So it just depends on your attitude and semantics. You can either say every place is the center of the universe, or no place is the center. It doesn't matter. What really matters is that the universe is expanding. And so what Hubble discovered was that the universe was expanding, and that changed everything. Because an expanding universe had a beginning. And then, of course, that changed not only physics, but in some sense philosophy, and theologians got quite excited by the fact that there was a beginning. But of course, when we knew there's a beginning, the big question is how it's going to end. And that became, in some sense, the business of cosmology for most of the rest of the 20th century. So it turned out Einstein, in 1915, developed his general theory of relativity and discovered something absolutely remarkable. That gravity is a result of the fact that matter and energy actually affect the properties of space and time. Matter can curve space. Energy can curve space. Space itself is not what we thought. Now, we live, it turns out, in a curved three-dimensional universe, but we can't picture curved three-dimensional universes because we are three-dimensional beings, and therefore we can't do that. But so that's why I've drawn two-dimensional pictures here. But the interesting thing is, the analogy is exact, that in a three-dimensional universe, once you know it can be curved, it can exist in one of three different kinds of geometries, so-called open, closed, or flat. And these are open, closed, and flat two-dimensional universes. They're not the universe we live in, but they're an analogy. The surface of a sphere is a closed two-dimensional object, and an infinite kind of horse's saddle is an open two-dimensional surface, and a flat piece of paper is a flat surface in two dimensions. Now, I can't picture these in three dimensions. I can tell you what would happen, for example, in a closed universe. If you looked far enough in that direction, you would see the back of your head. Light would literally travel around the universe, as it does in this case. And that all sounds great if you're at parties or afternoon events and stuff, but what really matters is, and the reason we care about this, is that if matter is the dominant stuff in the universe, then it determines our future. Because a closed universe full of matter will expand and then eventually stop and recollapse in a big crunch, the reverse of a big bang, and an open universe will go on expanding forever, and a flat universe will just the boundary between the two, it'll go on expanding, slowing down, never stopping. And so if we want to know the future, we want to know what kind of geometry we have for the universe. So that was the argument. And that's the reason I got into cosmology, as a matter of fact. I wanted to become the first person to know how the universe would end. It seemed like a good idea at the time. The question is, how can we determine which kind of universe we live in? Well, since matter curves space, quite simple. We just have to weigh the universe. And so that's what we do. And it's taken us about 80 years to do it, and I've written actually now two books in some sense about it. But I can tell you how it's done now in a much simpler way. But I want to take you back in history to a kindler, gentler car. And this is especially for the young people who may be scientists or budding scientists and will be constantly depressed. So, for reasons that I'll describe. So this is the magazine Science, which is a sort of distinguished scientific journal, 1936. And an article appeared called Lens-Like Action of a Star by the Deviation of Light in the Gravitational Field. Kind of verbose. But here's how it began. This is how the article began. Some time ago, R.W. Mandel paid me a visit and asked me to publish the results of a little calculation which I had made at his request. This note complies with his wish. So you try that nowadays and see what happens. Now, the author had credentials. His name was Albert Einstein, so it helps. And what he described here was the results of a calculation that he thought was so unimportant he didn't think it was worth publishing. It was the result of the realization that light he had shown, and what made him famous for the public at least in 1919, was the realization that light bends in a gravitational field. And that, in 1919, discovery was really made him a worldwide celebrity. But if you think about it, you realize if there's a large enough mass distribution, if you have a source of light behind that mass, the light can bend around it and converge again and be magnified, as my glasses magnify things. Or if I had a cut glass goblet, which I don't have, but I do have a glass of champagne, so I'll drink. I think if I drank this, I wouldn't be able to complete the talk. Anyway, if I had a cut glass goblet, I'd see many versions of you in the room. And he realized that space can act like a lens. And he called it gravitational lensing, but he said it would never be observable. Never be observable because the effect was so small. And in fact, it's kind of interesting. Here's his calculation in 1936, which Mr. Mandel convinced him to publish. The interesting thing about this is if you go back in the archives, you find that in 1912, he did an exactly same calculation. Here's his notebook from 1912. He just forgot he'd done it. And he didn't think it was worth doing. And my favorite part of this is the letter he wrote to the editor after it appeared. He wrote, "Let me also thank you for your cooperation with the little publication which Mr. Mandel squeezed out of me. It is of little value, but it makes the poor guy happy." So that's how science is done. It turns out that it is not of little value. It is, in fact, the way we weigh the universe. The very thing, Einstein was not very good at observation. Most things he said, in fact, everything that he said would ever be observable so far has been observed. And he didn't know enough to know about galaxies. He was thinking of just stars. But here's the very phenomenon that he said would never be observable. This is a cluster of galaxies. Clusters are the largest bound objects in the universe. Anything that can fall into anything will fall into a cluster. So if we can weigh clusters, we can essentially weigh the universe. And the clusters are, these cluster of galaxies, by the way, this cluster is about 5 billion light years away. Which is interesting. It means the light from these stars left before our sun formed. And in fact, it means many of these stars are dead now. And in fact, they took a picture of us our sun would have died already as well. Every time I look at a picture like this, people say science doesn't have spirituality, but an awe. But to me, when I look at a picture like this, it evokes so much more than so many other things that are supposed to evoke awe and wonder. In any case, this cluster about 5 billion light years away is about 10 million light years across. It takes light 10 million years to cross from one end of the cluster to the other. Almost all galaxies are part of clusters. We're part of one. But what's interesting is you see these weird blue things here, which you can see better again if the lights weren't on, but anyway. These weird blue things are multiple images of a single galaxy located 5 billion light years behind that cluster. A galaxy which in principle would be so faint we wouldn't even see it, but space has magnified it and produced many different images. All of these images are different images of the same object. This is evidence of the fact that space is curved around objects, that general relativity works. And it's remarkable. But as remarkable as it is, we understand general relativity, so we want to use it. So we want to use it, and in fact, we can use it to weigh this system, because we can then work backwards and say, how much mass must be in the system, and where is it distributed in order to produce the image that we see? It's a complicated thing called a mathematical inversion, but it can be done, and it's been done. And here's the result. And these are the spikes, and this is that image, and it projected, and the spikes are where the galaxies were in that image. But what you can see is, so this is the masses around the galaxy, but what you can see is that there's a huge mountain of mass where the galaxies aren't. There's 40 times as much mass in that picture as can be accommodated by adding up all the stars and all the galaxies. And in fact, around each galaxy, where the spike is, where the visible light is, there's also a mountain of mass, and there's at least 10 times more mass in each of these galaxies than can be accounted for by what you can see. And physicists, with their incredible linguistic perspicacity, call this dark matter, because it doesn't shine. But it's quite exciting, because there's 40 times as much dark matter in the system as accounted for by the stars, and for reasons I don't really have time to go into today, that means we're virtually certain that dark matter is made of something else. Not the particles that make you and I up, the protons and neutrons and all the rest. Some new type of elementary particle that doesn't really exist on Earth. And what makes that exciting is that means the dark matter is not just out there. If it's a gas, a dark matter, that means it's in here, it's in this room, going through all of your bodies, even as many of you nod off during this lecture. It goes right through your bodies, goes right through the Earth without even knowing it was there, because it interacts so weakly that it doesn't notice the Earth. That's why it doesn't shine. And that's exciting because if you're a particle physicist, we could learn that most of the stuff in the universe is made of something else. And in fact, what makes it even more exciting is it means we don't have to do observations to look at it. I have an experiment. In fact, Heidelberg here is one of the groups that, there's a bunch of groups that are looking for dark matter, and groups here at Heidelberg are doing it as well. This is a tetraction which I proposed about 30 years ago now. But it's now being used, and it's very simple to detect this dark matter. You just take, this is a boule of germanium, the same stuff that you find in your computers, and you just have to cool it to about 1/1000th of a degree above absolute zero, which is easy. And then the dark matter particles come through here, go right through the Earth. Most of them don't do anything, but maybe once a year, a dark matter particle will bounce off the nucleus of an atom of germanium, heating up the whole thing by 1/1000th of a degree. And that's more or less what you have to look for. And there are experiments in mines here in Europe, in the United States, in England, all looking for this dark matter. And if we discover it, well, we'll know what makes up the universe. What makes it even more exciting, and I wasn't going to mention this, but what the heck, we're almost at the threshold of discovering this stuff, perhaps, is there's a race. Because this is dark matter that was created at the beginning of time. But there's another place you might look for it, and that's to recreate the conditions at the beginning of time. Now, where can we do that? Nearby, in Geneva, at the Large Hadron Collider. So when that turns on again in February, there's a race, you see, because the next thing they want to detect are, we think that the dark matter particles might be particles that would be produced at the Large Hadron Collider. And so there's a race between these people who are trying to detect the ones created at the beginning of time and those trying to detect the ones that are created in February. And we don't know, or maybe neither of them will see anything. And it's very exciting, but it's irrelevant to us because we don't, for this point, for this argument, it doesn't matter what it is. The question is, how much of it is there? Because it will determine the dynamics we thought of the universe. So let's go back to this image. And the question is, how much stuff is there? And finally, after 80 years, we've been able to use images like this to finally weigh the universe. And we now know how much matter is in the universe. And I'm going to give you the answer right now with a drum roll. Well, that's not a drum roll. I don't even need to do that anymore because I play my music. Ready? Here we go. There it is. There are people fainting in the back of the room. Okay, what does this mean? Well, physicists, whenever they come up with a really important number, like to give it a Greek letter. And that's to sound scholarly. Okay, I was just talking to philosophers at Bonn, and we try and compete, so we call it. What happened? Didn't I have an image earlier? Now, I kicked out the sound, but that shouldn't kill the image.
Switch it on again.
Switch it on again.
That's the beamer. The beamer
is off. Oh, okay. But I didn't touch that. Who turned your beamer off? There's a BMW that's off? Okay, no. No, that's not mine. Yeah, you're right. There's no light coming from it anymore. Is the light blown? Oh, wouldn't that be hysterical? Well, I could get him to talk about that. It's a lot less. Do you think? My bet is your bulb is blowing, but we'll see. Yeah, I can show you the laptop if we have to. But we could all just huddle around the stage. I don't see any light coming from it yet. I suspect your light is bulb is blowing, because I think I see lights at the bottom of it.
Yeah, it's on.
It's on? Well, as you can see, well, this is dark matter, actually. Well, it'll be intriguing. I can try and do this without, well, it's all right. I mean, it's not the end of the world. You'll miss a lot of beautiful pictures, but I can still give this talk. But I suspect it's your light bulb. You want me to wait and check? Really hot. All you people are 80 watt heaters, and that means it gets very hot in this room. So, what do you think? My bet is it's a light bulb, and I'm a physicist. But I am a theoretical physicist, I should point out. Okay, so we have two choices. I assume, given where that projector is, that there's no way in hell you're going to get a light bulb into it. So I'll continue to talk for a while. And if you can get a new one, that'll be great. But I will talk, and we can do this. We'll suffer through it. Okay, well, you may remember that letter there was omega. And omega is so important, as I say, we give it a big letter. It means it's the ratio of the amount of matter in the universe divided by the amount of matter that you need to make a flat universe. And so, as you may remember, that number was 0.3. And that means we now know for certain that there's only 30% of the amount of matter needed to make the universe flat, so it looks like the universe is open. And so the Holy Grail has been discovered, the universe will expand forever, etc. Except there's a problem. We theoretical physicists knew the answer. We always know the answer. We're just rarely right. We knew that the universe was flat. We knew that, why? Because it's the only mathematically beautiful universe, basically, as I'll describe. And so, there was a problem because, only 30% of the universe, of the amount needed to make a flat universe is there. And so, there's a problem, of course, because there's a big loophole here. And that is, well, you're measuring the stuff around galaxies, but what about stuff that isn't where galaxies are? And, okay, this is going to be interesting. I'm looking at the next images. This is going to be fun. I think I can maybe do it. Okay, I'm going to need prop. Can I have this cope up? Is that okay? I just want to drink. No. Okay, so how can we measure? Well, it turns out, even after finally determining the amount of matter in the universe is way too small to make the universe flat, as I say, it's kind of indirect if we use general relativity, because we measure the amount of matter, we plug it into Einstein's equations, and then we run things through and we determine the curvature of the universe. Wouldn't it be better to measure the curvature of the universe directly? And that's what we've been able to do in the last 10 years. I never would have thought in my lifetime that we'd be able to do that. I actually wrote a paper 25 years ago about it, but I forgot it too. But we have been able, oh, look, I see a light. Oh, isn't this wonderful? Well, this is going to make it easier for me. Although I was prepared. I can give this back now, I don't need your, thank you. You get a free one of these bottles though for that. Okay, good. Here we are. Can we measure the... Oh, wow, this is just like a gift. So, how can we measure the geometry of the universe? Well, let's ask a simpler question. How can you measure the curvature of the Earth if you couldn't go around it or have a satellite to look at it? How would you know its curves? Well, the answer is you just draw a triangle. And you ask a European high school student, not an American one, what are the sum of the angles in a triangle? And they would tell you 180 degrees. You say, that's fine, but the problem is you learned your geometry from Euclid. Okay? Because on a curved surface, It's very different. That's why I need your bottom line. But anyway, let's take the surface of the Earth. And now I can draw a triangle as follows. I go along the equator, I make a right angle, I go up to the North Pole, and then make another right angle and come back down to the equator. So I have a triangle with three right angles, and 3 times 90 is 270, and 270 is not 180. So if I drew a triangle that was big enough on the surface of the Earth, I would know the Earth is curved. And so all we have to, turns out exactly the same thinking works for a curved three-dimensional space. So if we just found a triangle that was big enough, we can determine the curvature of the universe. And that's what's been possible in the last decade or so. We found a triangle big enough. This is an image of something called the cosmic microwave background, the afterglow of the Big Bang. To find a triangle that's big enough, we have to basically cross the entire universe. We have to look up out as far as we can see. And how far can we see? Well, we can only see as far as we can see. And just like if I look at this room, not that there because there's a window, but over here where there are none, I can only see to the walls because the walls are opaque. And if I look out at the universe, I keep looking, I'm doing cosmic archaeology, I'm going back in time, looking earlier and earlier and earlier. And you might think that if the universe is 13.8 billion years old, which it is, except in Mississippi and Alabama and a few other places, that we would see all the way back to the Big Bang. But we can't, because the universe became opaque between then and now. Back when the universe was about 300,000 years old, it was 3,000 degrees in temperature. And at that point, matter, normal neutral matter, can't exist. Because protons try and capture electrons, and they get broken apart. So you have what's called an ionized plasma, and a plasma is opaque to radiation. You can't see through it. So if we try and look further, we just can't see further with light. But this is as far as we can see. This is, it turns out, the microwave background radiation. One of the predictions of the Big Bang is the universe became transparent when it was 300,000 years old, and that light is coming at us from all directions. So the prediction of a Big Bang is there should be radiation coming at us from all directions. It's cooled now. It's 3 degrees above absolute zero, it turns out, in the microwave band. And it was what was discovered by accident in New Jersey, of all places, by two people who didn't know what the hell they were doing. But they won the Nobel Prize, because you don't have to know what you're doing to win the Nobel Prize. Seriously, you just have to do it, and they did it. And that second Nobel Prize was basically given for imaging this, because this is a baby picture of the universe. I think I have a better one, because I should preface this by saying, this is two-dimensional surface, spherical surface, located 13.8 billion light years, more or less, in all directions away from us, and I projected it onto a plane, just as we would for the surface of the Earth. So if this was the surface of the Earth, this would be North America and South America and Europe and Africa and Australia and Asia, etc. And so this weird stuff here is the plane of our galaxy. Our galaxy is a disk. And so this is up and that's down. And this is an image of that microwave background radiation. This is a baby picture of the universe, but the galaxy is nice, but we do get rid of it. So this is the most recent image from the Planck satellite. Talk about the Planck satellite here in Germany. And this is a picture of that radiation. What's beautiful about this baby picture, this is the red spots are a little hotter, the blue spots are a little colder. These are the primordial lumps created at the beginning of time that would later collapse to form all the galaxies and stars and planets and aliens and everything in the universe. And so we'd like to explain where these came from, and I may have time to talk about it, I may not. But what's important about this is that there are lumps. That it's not exactly uniform. It's almost exactly uniform. The hot spots are 1/1000th of a degree hotter than the cold spots. This whole thing is about 3 degrees. So the variations are about just 1 part in 10,000, which is a mystery. Was a mystery until recently. Why is the universe the same in all directions? And I don't have time really to go into that here, although I notice my friend Al Booth is coming later this term. He may be able to tell you about that. Now, those lumps, however, allow us to measure the curvature of the universe. Because here's that image of the microwave background. Here we are looking out at that surface when the universe was 3,000 degrees. And this distance of 1 degree is a very important scale. It represents a distance of 300,000 light years. 300,000 light years is the distance light can travel in a 300,000 year old universe. Now, Einstein told us no information can propagate faster than light. So nothing over here can ever affect anything over here. which is one of the reasons it's so weird that the universe is uniform everywhere. But this gives us a ruler and a triangle. Because if I have a lump of matter that's this big, it'll start to collapse due to gravity and do all sorts of nice things. But if I have a lump of matter that's this big around, it doesn't even know it's a lump, because gravity travels at the speed of light too. So it doesn't know it's supposed to collapse. It just sits there like Wile E. Coyote does in The Roadrunner, if you watch that, when he comes off the show. He waits for a while before he collapses. This thing will not collapse until light can travel across it. So the largest lumps that have begun to collapse are this big across, and you saw those lumps in that picture. Now that's a ruler, because it's at a known distance, 100,000 light year across lump, and if everything travels in straight lines, that will span 1 degree. But in a curved universe, it can be different, and that's why I have this whole picture. You see, here's this 300,000 light year across ruler, and it'll span 1 degree, but in an open universe, light rays diverge as I go back in time, so the same ruler will look smaller. It'll span 0.5 degree on our eyes. And in a closed universe, light rays converge as you go back in time, so the same ruler will look bigger. So all you have to do is measure those lumps and say, are they 0.5 degree, 1 degree, or 2 degrees? And we can do that. And here's an image of a small region in the microwave background. And this is the real universe. And here are universes we created on a computer. A closed, flat, and open universe. And in a closed universe, the average 300,000 light year across lump will look that big, but that's bigger than these lumps. And in an open universe, the average 300,000 light year across lump will be that big, but that's smaller than these lumps. But just like Goldilocks, in a flat universe, it's just right. And we now know to an accuracy of better than 1% that our universe is flat. And by the way, just so I'll anticipate some of your questions, what is a flat universe? It's the universe you always thought you lived in. It's a universe where the X, Y, and Z axes are always pointing in the same direction. I use Z because I'm in Germany, you know, some culture study. But light rays travel in straight lines. So it's a universe you always thought you lived in. In a curved universe, if you follow the Y direction in very far here, somewhere else it'll be pointing over there. Okay? So we now know that we live in a flat universe. So we theorists can do this. Pat ourselves on the back. But there's a problem because, and you may not remember before the traumatic event with the light going off, but just a few minutes ago, I proved to you that there's only 30% of the amount of stuff needed to make the universe flat. So 70% of the stuff in a flat universe isn't there. Now, if it's not in galaxies or around galaxies, it's got to be where galaxies aren't. But what is where galaxies aren't? Nothing. Now, nothing has changed. This is a picture of nothing. Due to the laws of quantum mechanics and special relativity, we now know, in fact, Feynman was one of the first people to point this out, we now know that empty space is not empty. It's a boiling, bubbling brew of virtual particles popping in and out of existence in a time scale so short you can't see them. Now, that sounds like counting angels on the head of a pin, so it sounds like theology. If you can't see them, then, you know, if you invent things you can't see, it's not science. But we can't see them directly, but we can see their effects indirectly. And that's how we know they're there. And in fact, this is an image that was shown at the Nobel Prize ceremonies in 2004 or so, by my friend Frank Wilczek. This is this empty space inside of a proton. This is an animation, of course, but it's based on mathematical calculations from our theory of what's called a strong interaction. This is the empty space inside a proton. Now, if you went to a good school, and you're all from Germany, so you probably did, you learn that a proton is made of 3 quarks, right? Because you know this, because that's German cheese. But, Americans don't. But, took a while for that one. But anyway, when we tell you a proton is made of 3 quarks, we of course lie. It is made of 3 quarks, but there's other stuff. Here's a picture of the virtual particles and fields that are popping in and out of existence at any instant in the proton. And why they're important is they give most of the mass of the proton. If you add up the mass of the quarks, it's only about 10% at best of the mass of the proton. Most of the mass comes from these virtual fields that are popping in and out of existence. So, if they can give energy to the proton, maybe they can give energy to the universe. So we do a similar calculation, and this is the reason they won the Nobel Prize, is this works, okay? We can ask, how much energy might these virtual particles give to empty space. We did a calculation, we come up with the worst prediction in all of physics. We calculate that the energy of empty space should be roughly a gazillion times the energy of everything we see, which is absolutely impossible. If it were, we wouldn't exist. As I say, it is literally the worst prediction. Well, some of my colleagues may make worse predictions, but the worst one I know of. Because we predict the energy of empty space should be roughly 120 orders of magnitude larger than the energy of everything we see. And we know it can't be much more than the order of everything we see. So that's a problem. Now, when I was a student, we knew the answer, because I'm a theoretical physicist. Okay? We could go to bed at night because we knew the answer. The answer had to be zero. That's the only sensible answer, because we don't know how to cancel a number to 120 decimal places and leave a non-zero answer in the 121st decimal place. We don't know how to do that in science. But zero is a beautiful number. We know how to make zeros easily. We have symmetries, new symmetries in nature, that have things that cancel exactly, and you end up with zero. Yeah, so we knew the answer was zero. It had to be the only sensible answer. But the nice thing about cosmology is it's actually an empirical discipline. And so even though we knew the answer, it's good to check it. And so all you have to do is weigh empty space. Let me point this out. What I'm talking about is that if this were true, empty space, you get rid of all the particles and all the radiations, you have a bit of space right here, it would weigh something. Which is just crazy. That's why we knew it was zero. Okay? But we can ask, what would it do if it wasn't zero? Well, it turns out, this is that Hubble diagram of distance versus velocity. Further objects away are moving faster. This is what Mr. Hubble measured. But because the universe should be slowing down, because any of you who've taken physics know this, the gravity sucks, right? But in fact, if you have energy in empty space, gravity blows, okay? The gravity of empty space becomes repulsive. And so in 1998, two groups of astronomers who didn't know what the hell they were doing were trying to measure the speed at which the universe was slowing down, okay? And now, the problem is, in order to measure this, you have to do a good job, better than Mr. Hubble did. And I think, here's Mr. Hubble's data from 1929. This is one of the reasons he was such a great scientist. He knew to draw a straight line through this data set. But he did everyone a favor, especially astronomers. He got the answer wrong by a factor of 10, and they tried to emulate that ever since. But it was a real interesting controversy, you see, because he discovered the universe was expanding 10 times faster than it actually is. And this was remarkable, because if the universe is expanding faster, then you can actually determine its age, and it's 10 times younger. And if you work out and plug this number in, this was in 1929, the age of the universe was 1.5 billion years old. Which was embarrassing, because in 1929 we already knew that the Earth was much older than 1.5 billion years old. And it's embarrassing when the Earth is older than the universe. And this is interesting, because it could have been wrong. It could have been that there's something wrong with our picture. But happily, Mr. Hubble was wrong, and he got it wrong by a factor of 10, the universe is closer to 15 billion years old. He didn't get the answer wrong because he wasn't a good astronomer. He got the answer wrong because it's hard to measure distances in the universe. How do you measure distances? You don't tape measures that are that long. I can measure, and happily that light is working now. If I wanted to measure the distance to the back of the room, and I took off the lens, and I had an old-fashioned camera, and there's some of the people here old enough to remember light meters on cameras, I could say, well, if that's 500 watts, and I see 1 watt of light in my camera, I know how light spreads out, I can work out the distance to the back of the room. So if the universe was full of 500 watt light bulbs, we'd be fine. But we don't have them, so we look for what's called a standard candle, something whose intrinsic brightness for other reasons, we're sure we know. Then we look at it through a telescope, we see how bright it looks, and then we know how far away it is. Okay? And that's what the problem of Mr. Hubble. He didn't have a good standard candle, but we have a good one now. Here's a good standard candle. This is another of my favorite Hubble Space Telescope images. It looks like a painting, but it's not. This is a galaxy long, long ago, far, far away. Actually, it's not that far away. It's only 70 million light years away. Okay? And it's a spiral galaxy like our own, about 100 billion stars or 10 billion stars in the center. And what you notice is that this star over here is shining with the brightness of 10 billion stars, which is a problem. Now, The reasonable thing would be to say, well, that's just a star that's in our galaxy that got in the way of the picture. And that would be the most sensible prediction. But it turns out not to be. It's really a star in this galaxy that's shining with a brightness of 10 billion stars. How could that be? It's a star that's just exploded. Exploding stars are the brightest fireworks in the universe, supernovae. They shine briefly a period of a month or so with the brightness of 10 billion stars. And these kind of supernovae are wonderful standard candles, it turns out. And we can now use them to observe the universe. Now, it's good for us that stars don't explode too often. But it's actually good for us that stars explode. As some of you know, I've talked about this a little bit, it's the most poetic thing I know in the universe. Because all of the atoms in your body have been in an exploding star, essentially. Because the only elements that were made in the Big Bang were hydrogen, helium, and a little bit of lithium. Okay, but the important, well, lithium may be important for some people in this room, but the important stuff, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, all of the rest of the stuff, was only produced in the nuclear furnaces and stars, and the only way it could get into your body is if the stars were kind enough to explode. So every atom in your body has been not in one, just one star. The atoms in your left hand and the right hand may have come from different stars, many stars. Every atom in your body has experienced the most violent explosion in nature probably many times. I think you are literally stardust. And it's true, and to me, as I say, I don't know anything more poetic than that. So take that away from this, if nothing else. But now, if they only explode once every 100 years per galaxy, which is how often stars explode, you might say, how can we study these things? Well, it's simple. You just assign a graduate student to each galaxy. 100 years is about the right time for a PhD. And it doesn't matter if they die because graduate students are cheap. We don't have to do that. Because the other thing that I want you to take away from this, and it's something that I wish more people understood, is that the universe is big and old, and therefore rare events happen all the time. All the time. For example, if there's so many galaxies, if you held a poll out about this, I think one of your 50, I don't know if it's called 50 cents, is it called 50 cents?
Yeah.
Good, 50 cent pieces. And and went outside the city here and looked at a dark spot in the sky about that size, you'd see about 100,000 galaxies with one of the brightest, biggest telescopes we have on Earth in Chile. 100,000 galaxies. And that means once per 100 years per galaxy means in that region, on a given night, you'd see a few stars explode. And astronomers do that. They apply for telescope time and look for stars to explode, and they find them. And here we can make movies of them. Here's one exploding, and we can measure it over a period of a month as it gets bright and dark, and you'll see it explode again. We measure its colors to know exactly what kind of supernova it is. And these are wonderful standard candles. And these astronomers in 1998 used these wonderful standard candles to measure the rate at which the universe was slowing down. And what did they discover? Much to their surprise, something quite different. Here's this Hubble plot, and I want to make it simpler. So there's a super galaxy's velocity and function distance, more or less. And in order to make it clear, I just want to draw a straight line through this and pick the whole data set and move it horizontal. If the universe had been slowing down, as predicted by most people up to that point, these supernovae the distant supernovae would lay along this curve. And you notice they don't. They're not even along the straight line. They're above the straight line. What does that mean? Well, one of two things. Either the data is wrong, which it usually is. It is. Don't believe data when you see it the first time in any field of science. But in this case, it turns out to be right. The other possibility is the universe is speeding up. The expansion of the universe is accelerating, which was a shock. But just for fun, we say, well, how much energy would you have to put in empty space to make the universe expand and speed up the way this is done with this curve here? You need to put in exactly what we're missing. If you put 70% of the energy of a flat universe in empty space, everything works. And this is the cockamamie universe we now live in, where everything has changed, where we've seen that those images of stars and galaxies that you saw before is just the tip of a cosmic iceberg. We are just a bit of cosmic pollution in a universe full of dark matter and dark energy. 70% of the energy of the universe resides in nothing, 30% in dark matter, and maybe 1% or so in everything we see. So you could get rid of all the stars and all the galaxies and everything that's important to us, and the universe would be largely the same. So much for a universe made for us. So lesson one. You are much more insignificant than you thought. And by that I mean you, not me. No, no, we're all. We are irrelevant to the dynamics of the universe. But But that, and that's the picture we've come up with in the last 100 years, and I want to talk about the consequences of that. So, to summarize, and this is, that's the empirical data I really want to show for the moment, for the end. The dominant energy in the universe resides in empty space. We have no idea why it's there. That's what's important. If anyone comes here and lectures to you, like my friend Brian Greene might later in the year, if they're a string theorist especially, don't believe them. If they tell you, they know the answer to this question. We don't know. Its existence is probably tied to the very nature of space and time and to the origin of our universe, and more importantly, as I'll describe in the end, it will determine our future. It will determine the future of the universe, and we don't know why it's there. It is the biggest mystery in science. Because our naive predictions tell us it should be 120 orders of magnitude bigger, or it should be zero. No one has the slightest idea why empty space weighs something, and weighs the amount it does. Okay. Now, how will the universe end? Okay, I'm glad I have this image, because I want to take you back to your favorite time as a youth. Physics class. We have a coin. I could take a coin and throw it up. I'm not going to bother. Imaginary coin I throw up, comes back down. If I throw it up faster, goes up a little higher, comes back down. If there's no ceiling and I throw it up really fast, it doesn't come down. And we teach high school students how to calculate this, and I want to take you through it for just a second. We tell students, okay, when I throw a coin up, it has energy, and that energy has two pieces. It has a positive piece, which I call kinetic energy, the energy of motion, and a negative piece due to the gravitational attraction of the Earth, and then everything just becomes bookkeeping. If the total energy of that coin, the positive piece beats the negative piece, the coin will escape. If the negative piece beats the positive piece, the coin will return, and if they're exactly equal, that determines the escape velocity from the Earth. That's how NASA decides how fast to shoot rocket ships. Well, it turns out we can do the same thing for the universe if it's full of matter. Because we take that little region that Hubble looked at, and if the universe is the same everywhere, and as I tried to show you, it is, then what happens to every galaxy will happen to any galaxy. Or the other way around. What happens to any galaxy will happen to every galaxy. So if I want to figure out if the universe is going to collapse, I just have to look at a region of the universe, we're at the center here, and look at some galaxy here that's moving away from us, and ask, will it eventually come out? To determine that, just do that high school physics calculation. I calculate the positive part of its energy, that just comes from the expansion rate Mr. Hubble gave us. The negative piece comes from the total amount of mass inside the sphere, including dark matter, and that's a negative piece. And if the negative piece beats the positive piece, if B over A is bigger than 1, this will come back. If B over A is less than 1, then this thing will escape. Now, what's amazing, truly amazing, is that this ratio, B over A, is nothing other than that quantity omega. The ratio of the actual amount of matter in the universe divided by the amount of matter needed to make a flat universe. And we now know the value of omega. It's not 0.3 because we found out about dark energy. It's 1 because the universe is flat. Omega is 1 in a flat universe. And we now know that omega is 1. But if omega is 1, then B over A is 1. And that means B is equal to A. But if B is equal to A, then the negative piece is equal to the positive piece. But if that's the case, the total energy of every object in our universe is precisely 0. Now, if you were going to make a universe from nothing, what would you make your total energy? There you go. Okay, we're getting to the point. As I'll describe now, everything we know about our universe suggests it could have come from nothing without any supernatural shenanigans. Because the total energy of our universe could be 0, as you'll see. So now let me ask this question, why is there something rather than nothing? I want to give you a bunch of different answers. First answer is, well, the really interesting question would be, why was there nothing rather than something? But if there was a question, we wouldn't be here to ask it. Because, in fact, empty space is unstable. Remember, empty space is really a boiling, bubbling brew of virtual particles. When you add gravity to the mix, you are guaranteed that if you wait long enough, empty space will start bubbling out particles due to quantum mechanics. So empty space is unstable. You shouldn't have empty space for a long time. You'd always have enough stuff, eventually enough stuff to produce everything we see. So that's the simple answer. Empty space is unstable. So if you take, this is the kind of nothing of the Bible. Now there are different versions of nothing. The nothing of the Bible is a dark, eternal, empty void. That's sort of empty space. That kind of nothing can't exist for long. So it's no big surprise that there's stuff in our universe. Now you might say, well, that's not really nothing because there's no stuff there. But what about space itself? Well, if we apply quantum mechanics to gravity, then when you put gravity and quantum mechanics together, then the variables of gravity are space and time. And quantum mechanics says that the variables should fluctuate. So if gravity is a quantum theory, then space and time fluctuates. But that says that whole universes of space and time can suddenly pop into existence for a little while and disappear. Virtual universes can appear and disappear. And most of them will appear and disappear in an instant. But if I were to create a virtual universe that had zero total energy, then the laws of physics tell me it can exist for an arbitrary long time. So I can pop universes into existence by quantum gravity if they have zero total energy. Now you might say, great, well you just told me this, so our universe can exist, pop into existence from nothing. But in fact, it's not quite the case. Because it turns out, and I wish it would be a simpler thing to tell you, but I'd like to be honest. It turns out that we can't actually calculate the total energy of any kind of universe except a closed universe. When we do that, the energy of a closed universe is zero. But we live in a universe that's flat, so what gives? Well, a closed universe, as I say, will generally collapse in a fraction of a second. The only way to make it last long enough is to have this short period early on when empty space has energy again, a lot of energy, and it expands very fast, so fast that if it was going to collapse, it would take a long time to do so. It turns out this is just what particle theory predicts. And as I say, Alan Guth is going to be here in 1980. He predicted it. This phenomenon he called inflation says, if he's right, and the particle physics is right, that very early times when the universe is a billionth of a billionth of a billionth of a billionth of a second old, the universe suddenly expanded by a huge amount due to an energy stuck in empty space for a little while before it got released into a hot big bang. And the volume of our universe increased by a factor of 10 to the 90th in a billionth of a billionth of a billionth of a billionth of a second. It sounds impossible. In that time, our observable universe went, and all of the mass and energy contained in 100 billion galaxies, each of which contained 100 billion stars, was contained at the beginning of inflation in a region the size of a single atom. All of that stuff, it's hard to think, we could talk about that with a straight face, but all that stuff was contained in such a region. At the end of inflation, it was the size of a basketball. Now, what happens during that? And the reason I'm adding this is because this is a discovery that was just made a few months ago that might be the most important discovery in the history of science. So I felt I would be remiss if I didn't tell you about it. Here's that microwave background radiation. Here are the little lumps put in the beginning of time. What's really neat is inflation actually says that quantum mechanics will produce these lumps. And you could actually calculate what they should look like. They look like that. But the problem is these lumps were seen before, and if science isn't based on postdiction, it's based on prediction. So to really know if inflation happened, we want to see a prediction of something other than this. But the problem is we can only see back to 300,000 years after the Big Bang, and inflation happened at a billionth of a billionth of a billionth of a billionth of a second after the Big Bang. How can we see all the way back? Well, we can't use light, because light stops right there. So we want to use something that's weaker than light, that'll make it through from the beginning of the universe to now without being impeded. What can we use? Gravity. When I wave my hands, I produce a disturbance in space, according to Einstein, because my hands are curving space around it. And a moving disturbance of space produces a moving disturbance of space. We call that a gravitational wave, a wave of space and time. In fact, if there was such a wave in this room, if it were coming out of the board, it would look like this. If we're coming out of the board, what a gravitational wave would do is it'd make this room shrink in one direction and stretch in another direction. And shrink in this direction and stretch in that direction. It would literally be a disturbance of space, and if you like three-dimensional images, that probably give less information. This looks like a little snake, but that's it. That's what the wave looks like in three dimensions. Gravitational waves created by inflation would make it all the way here. And we predicted that, actually, in 1992. Well, it turns out they would produce a signal in the microwave background. And this is a detector called the bicep detector, which is at the South Pole. Microwave receiver at the South Pole, and even though the South Pole is relatively cold, it's not cold enough. Here is during the summer. By the way, maybe you don't know this. I didn't know this till maybe a decade ago. It shocked me. We can send astronauts to the moon. Well, maybe we did, and we can, and we can send people to the bottom of the ocean. But you can't go to Antarctica in the wintertime. You can't fly there. No planes fly in or out in the wintertime. So during the summer in Antarctica, we fly planes in to stock up these experiments, and then we send graduate students down there to stay the winter, and they do their work. This is actually a cargo plane delivering liquid helium to this experiment, because although it's 100 degrees below zero in the winter in Antarctica, that's not cold enough. This is about 270 degrees below zero Celsius, and that's cold enough, so we stock that up. And this is one of my favorite pictures. It's in a Scientific American article I just wrote that appeared this last week. This is the bicep experiment. This is at sunset. This may not seem so special to you, but you gotta remember how often sunset happens in the South Pole. Okay? If you're the photographer, you miss it, you gotta wait a year. It happens once a year. Okay, and then sunrise 6 months later. Also, if you're the photographer where this photo's taken, you're stuck. Because this is the instant between summer and winter, and once this sun goes down, you're there for the duration. Anyway, this detector, it turns out this is a prediction of what the micro, here are the hot spots and cold spots, the microwave background. It turns out, and I don't have time to go into it adequately today, that the gravitational waves from inflation will polarize that radiation, will cause it to point in different directions. And it's a very particular kind of pointing that gravitational waves produce. It's a kind of corkscrew-like pointing. So here's the prediction made of what it would look like. And March 18th of this year, the BICEP experiment reported this observation, which is amazing. It's exactly what was predicted. Exactly. Now, if this is true, this could be the most important image in the history of science. Because this is an image, first of all, the first direct detection of gravitational waves, but secondly, of processes that happened when the universe was a billionth of a billionth of a billionth of a billionth of a second old. At the Big Bang. And it would change our empirical handle on the universe by a factor of 10 to the 49th in time. You don't do that every day. And so this was heralded as remarkable. The neat thing about science, though, is, as Feynman said, when you come up with something remarkable, you try and prove it right, but you also try and prove it wrong. It's something the Catholic Church proved. About miracles. And the problem is, that when the experiment was first done, this is the actual data, this is what you take from inflation, and this is the data, it's exactly what we expect, and don't worry about what any of this means. When they did this, they looked up, away from our galaxy, because there wasn't much dust in our galaxy looking up. And dust can reproduce the kind of signal they were looking for, so they wanted to look in the dust-free region. And these were estimates of the effect of dust. The problem is, within a month of the time of this experiment, another experiment, the Planck satellite, actually measured the dust in our galaxy. Not in exactly the region they looked at, but in a different region, and then there's some extrapolations, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And they just published a paper about the same day my article came out in Scientific American, actually. This is that prediction. This is that little bump there that they see right here. And this is the possible, with uncertainties, impact of dust. And you can see that it's the same order of magnitude as the same. Now, I'm amazed that so many people say, oh, it's not there. I still have two bets going that it's really there. Okay, two $1 bets, so I'm serious. because there are features of the signal that, well, dust would produce a uniform signal here, and it could just be an accident. It could just be an unfortunate accident. But you notice that this mimics the signal exactly. It goes down when the signal slows down, goes up when the signal goes up. I mean, it's consistent statistically with a straight line. But, you know, they may have just been very unlucky and dust may have produced an accidental observation. But it might be right. And if it is right, then this is direct evidence that inflation happened. Direct measurement of the universe when it was a billionth of a billionth of a billionth of a billionth of a second after the Big Bang. Measuring the universe on scales of energy and time that we'll never do directly on Earth. And if inflation happened, what it does is it makes a closed universe look flat. So the only closed universe that could exist for long enough for us to be here would be, would be a universe in which inflation happened, because every other closed universe will collapse. So if you asked what would be the characteristics of the universe that was created from nothing by ordinary processes of physics, it would be precisely the characteristics of the universe we live in. Does that prove our universe came from nothing? No, it just makes it plausible, and that's what's so neat. It's what Darwin did for a life, 150 or two, almost 150 years ago or so. Darwin didn't know about DNA and the genetic details of life, but he showed it was plausible, given genetic mutation and natural selection, that all the diversity of life could come from a single form of life. What we've now shown is the same thing. It's plausible that our universe came from nothing. You don't need anything supernatural to make it, and indeed, if you ask what would the universe look like if it came from nothing, it would look like our universe. Now I want to end with, let's see, because I added that, and because we had that delay because of the projector, I don't want to go on too long. I have another 5 minutes or 7 minutes. Should I include this, or, you're very hot. You okay?
Yes.
Okay. Those who said no were too embarrassed. You might as well learn about this because you'll hear about it. Remember, we're not the center of the universe, but we've now somehow returned to being the center of the universe because there's a strange thing. This is a brief history of time. This is the density of matter in the universe. This is the density of, so it goes down as the universe expands. This is the energy density of empty space. It stays constant because there's nothing to get diluted, right? And we are living today, right here, if this picture's correct, where the energy of empty space is three times the energy of matter. But you look at this, and it's obvious that there's something strange about this picture. We are living in the only time in the history of the universe when these two numbers are about the same. At all earlier times, the energy of matter would be much greater. At all later times, the energy density of empty space. Why should we be living at the only time in the history of the universe when those two numbers are the same? That's not what Copernicus told us. That's not the way it's supposed to be. There's nothing special about 13.8 billion years. And this coincidence has driven physicists crazy. And they say, well, what's a possible solution? Well, a possible solution is galaxies exist. Now, why is that? Well, if I made the energy of empty space, say, 50 times bigger, then this line would be that line. And then the two curves would not cross here, they cross here. But what time is that? That's the time of galaxies first formed. But if the energy of empty space, which is gravitationally repulsive, was bigger than the energy of matter before galaxies formed, galaxies wouldn't form. And if galaxies didn't form, stars wouldn't form. So maybe this is telling us something, and it's led to something I call anthropic mania. If there are many different universes, and the energy of empty space can vary in each one, then only those in which it's not much greater than what we measure today will galaxies form. And only then will stars and planets form, and only then will astronomers form. So the universe is the way it is because there are astronomers here to measure. Okay? It sounds religious almost. It's not. It's cosmic natural selection, if it's true. It would be amazing to find ourselves living in a universe in which we couldn't live. I mean, that would be worth writing a book about. But it's not surprising. It's just like bees appear tuned to be able to see the color of flowers, not because they're designed to do so, because if they didn't, they wouldn't survive. The universe seems to be fine-tuned for us because we're fine-tuned for the universe. If the universe was different, we wouldn't be here. Now, so this idea that maybe there are many different universes become interesting, and most people would call that metaphysics, as they should. But what's really neat, and I want to mention it here, is because if inflation happens, it automatically produces many universes. Because inflation puffs up space, but it turns out what causes that puffing up to end, it's kind of like ice crystals forming on your window. As the universe cools, suddenly a seed forms somewhere, and that energy stored in empty space gets dissipated. So that energy gets dissipated in one place, it causes a big bang, it causes the universe, but most of space is still expanding somewhere else. Later on, perhaps, a seed forms and energy gets dissipated, another big bang happens. Maybe there are universes that are just forming right now in this thing we now call a multiverse. And what's also interesting is inflation, the way it ends, it can end differently. Just like on a window, the ice crystals can point in different directions randomly. When inflation ends, it turns out the end can produce a universe that has different laws of physics. So you can have many different universes produced from inflation, each of which has different laws of physics. And so this multiverse that might explain why the energy of empty space is what it is actually is well-founded if inflation happened. But what I really want to point out is if that image is correct, we could test this idea. We could test the theory of inflation. We can find the right model. We can determine if, in fact, it had to be great many universes. And we know, therefore, we will never, ever be able to directly see those other universes. We will know they exist. We turn metaphysics into physics. And that would be amazing. But to really end, I want to talk about the last kind of nothing, because I want to end by telling you the future. And the future is miserable. I think that's a good, appropriate way to end on a beautiful day. The first person to realize that was George Orwell, who said to see what is in front of one's nose requires a constant struggle. Okay? And this is, of course, what he meant by it. What he meant was that in a universe dominated by the energy of empty space, it keeps speeding up. But that means objects will go move away from us faster and faster and faster, and eventually they'll be moving faster than the speed of light. So objects at some distances greater than some distance are receding faster than the speed of light. That is allowed in general relativity. You can't move through space faster than light, but space can do whatever the hell it wants. And we can calculate that distance, where objects are now receding from us faster than the speed of light. It's about 18 billion light years away from us. The effects are now just becoming visible. But this means the longer we wait, the less we will see. Galaxies we could see today will soon be traveling away from us faster than light, and observers in the future couldn't see them because the light will never make its way to us. So, what will the future be? Well, the rest of the universe will disappear. And I like to think it's very poetic to me. I like to think of observers 2 trillion years from now, which, by the way, there'll still be stars around in 2 trillion years, main sequence stars, and therefore there'll be civilizations that can evolve around those stars, the carbon, etc. And there'll be astronomers that will develop in those civilizations, and they'll learn the laws of quantum mechanics and electromagnetism and gravity, and they'll build telescopes. And they'll look out, and what will they see? They'll see the universe we thought we lived in 100 years ago. A universe with a single galaxy surrounded by empty space, eternal and unchanging. Because all evidence of the Big Bang will have disappeared, because all the galaxies that are moving away from us now that tell us the universe is expanding will no longer be visible. So in the far future, they'll do the best possible science they can do, and they'll come up with a picture, which is the wrong picture that we had 100 years ago. And we're lucky enough to live in the current time. Now, eventually, the stars in our galaxy will burn out, and the universe will become cold and dark and empty. And when I explained this to my late good friend, Christopher Hitchens, who I used to talk to about science all the time, he came and he said, you know, and he was actually writing the foreword for this new book before he died. He came up with a different answer to why is there something rather than nothing. He said, just wait. There won't be for long. Okay? So the real answer to the question of why is there something rather than nothing is, well, we tend to think we're the pinnacle of the universe, so it's always going to be the way it is. But in fact, in the future, there'll be nothing again. And, you know, I don't want to depress you too much, because the two things I told you, well, let's get back to the two things I told you. Let me just give you the good news before you get too depressed. We live in a very special time. The only time that we can observationally verify that we live in a very special time. By that I mean, I'm facetious, I'm sure all observers, that's a time-invariant statement. We can see things now, but maybe in 2 trillion years they could see things that we couldn't see that will change various aspects that we now think. Not the stuff we've measured, because the stuff we've measured we know is right. But the stuff we haven't measured may change. So, science has demonstrated that a universe for nothing is not only plausible, but likely. What we mean by something nothing has completely changed from the time the classical philosophers and theologians first raised this question of why is there something rather than nothing. Now, I raise that point because there are many people who are angry at me for changing the definition of nothing. But I tell them we have a word for that in science. It's called learning. We learn that nothing is not quite what we thought it was before, but that's okay. But the real point is the important question is not why is there rather than nothing. The real question that's important is how did the universe evolve and how can we find out? And we are living at this amazing time when we have learned so much in the last 40 or 50 years, when our picture of the universe has changed so much, where we can now see 100 billion galaxies, but we now have learned that we see is just really just the very tip of reality. And the real universe is far more interesting than anything any science fiction writer or the human imagination can come up with. We are constantly surprised. And every day I wake up and I'm surprised if I'm not surprised. So, the two things I told you are, first, you are incredibly insignificant, and secondly, the future is miserable. Those are the two things I want to take you to take away from this, but you shouldn't be depressed. Because here we are at this random moment, able, with our telescopes and our accelerators, to understand the earliest moments of the Big Bang and measure the universe across its large scale just because of this accident of consciousness. So instead of being depressed about your insignificance and the future, you should enjoy your brief moment in the sun. Thank you very much.